Mwana ngani sino tsiyai mwana we na likuti tamwita neno yoti ambepo wabwera Okay. Okay. What is Ajibanga? Okay, fine. I want us to look at these three. Let me go for it. Can you get something? We'll be looking at the cellphone. Ni akwona ukugira phone ndikudrosa. Diwe. Okay. Hey, Chetewa. Okay, first of all, I want us to look at those three bulletins. Want us to look at the communication which is supposed to be there with the people who are having mental health problems. In connection to use of self empathy, use of silence, and respect and dignity of service user. Want to look at or to go through those three first of all. What are they trying to tell us? Use of self empathy in connection to communicating with the people who are having mental health problems. Use of self empathy. You are social workers.
We need to answer.
No. You are social workers, your community development officers. Then your job is to communicate with the people with or who are having mental problems. Now, in connection to use of self-empathy, how are you going to look into this issue? Using self-empathy when communicating with the people with mental health. We know empathy. It's one of the skills, right? Which you as social workers are supposed to apply when you'll be dealing with those people who are having mental problems, mental health problems. A good example of mental health problem could be what? Depression. What else? Stress. Is it a mental health problem?
It affects the mental health.
Mm-hmm. and so on and so forth. Now, here we are looking at you as a social worker. You're supposed to have that skill for a reason. Or if you want your work to be successful, that of dealing with such kind of people. Here they are saying, using self-empathy when communicating with people with mental health problems. This one involves you as social workers are there to recognize your own emotions and biases. As human beings, you are emotional sometimes when you're handling situations, more especially dealing with such kind of people. Some of them are very troublesome. And I'm a mental health. Ena, they are boring. Sionjo. Atawisa. But you are asked to recognize your emotions and your biases. Please take note of that. In as far as use of self-empathy. Self-empathy, that's the feeling. You should have the feeling or the feelings which that patient is having, be in his or her shoes. Don't overreact. Only if you are not going to overreact, it means you are recognizing yourself, you are recognizing your emotions and biases as well. Two, when you're talking about using self-empathy, this again, apart from recognizing your own emotions and biases, you are also supposed to do what? To acknowledge the impact of your own experiences on your communication styles. You need to acknowledge the impact or the effect of your experiences. You have experiences on your communication skills. Do you have a lesson here which is communication skills?
Yes,
you learn communication skills. So they tell you how you are supposed to conduct yourself when you're communicating with others, right? Remember, nature of your work, one of the skills which you're supposed to uphold is communication. Communication skills or communicating skills. So they are telling you when you're supposed to use self-empathy, you need to involve acknowledgement of the impacts of your own experiences. You need to know how to handle such kind of people with mental health problems. The third point, you are also supposed to practice self-compassion and stress management. Stress management. Are you aware of stress management? You need to manage stresses. You need to manage well. You need to manage well stresses when you are practicing self-compassion, when you are communicating with those people who are having mental health problems. You should also be aware of your non-verbal styles and body language. Be aware of your non-verbal conduct and body language. The way how you conduct yourself when you're communicating with somebody speaks volumes of who you really are. If you care about whatever you are trying to bring to that particular patient, this will be known by the way how you are handling that particular patient. So you need to be aware of your non-verbal as well as body language. Your face also can tell a lot of stories. Do you care or you don't care? Are you genuine or you're just pretending? Are you caring or not? A patient or those people who have escorted a patient or a client to you can describe you the way how you are looking to them. Another point is reflecting. Self-efficacy is reflecting on your own mental health and well-being. That's another point. You are social workers, again, you should avoid judgment and assumptions. Don't judge. Every now and again, I've been telling you previously that be non-judgmental. Be non-judgmental because you are there to bring support to such kind of people. But don't try to judge them. Don't ever try to judge them. Embrace imperfection and uncertainty. That's another point. You need to embrace imperfection. Not always. The things you'll be doing will instantly be perfect. Or those people will be coming to you, they'll be perfect. No. You need to embrace such kind of scenarios. Embrace such scenarios which are imperfect, at the same time, uncertain. So, those are some of the points which you are supposed to know, which are in line with self-empathy. I don't know if you have any question on those points which I have just highlighted to you. Any question? Now, if you don't have any question, let me also talk about the importance of self-empathy. Self-empathy, or to be self-empathetic, is very essential. It's very essential when you are communicating with the people with mental health issues. Why do you think self-empathy is essential when you are communicating with such kind of people with mental health issues? Okay, self-empathy will help you to stay calm, and composed in challenging situations. There are some situations which can cause you to overreact. But if you have self-empathy, it means you'll be helped in the sense that you stay calm and composed in those challenging situations. Apart from that one, again, self-empathy is important because it will help you to respond empathetically and compassionately. You'll be handling your things empathetically, at the same time, compassionately. You have compassion when you are dealing with those challenging situations. Again, self-empathy will help you to set realistic boundaries. You'll be in a position to set realistic boundaries. And also you'll be in a position to prioritize self-care. You'll be able to prioritize self-care. Self-empathy is also essential because it will help you to improve communication and also build trust. Also build trust. You improve communication, at the same time, you also improve or build trust. Furthermore, self-empathy will help you to cultivate a safe and supportive environment. So by practicing self-empathy, you as social workers can enhance your emotional intelligence. Apart from that one, you also improve communication and the relationships, that is building trust. You'll also be in a position to increase empathy and compassion and also reduce stress and burn out. So remember that self-empathy is not self-pity. Self-empathy is not the same as self-pity. So it's about acknowledging your own humanity to better support others. Your duty there, you're trying to support others. Remember, you're trying to communicate with the people who are having mental challenges or problems. So that's all about use of self-empathy. I don't know if you have any question on whatever I've been talking about. The last point. I talked about, it's not self-pity. It's not about self-pity. I feel pity for myself. No, it's not that. Okay, let us have a look at the second bulletin, which is talking about use of silence. Sometimes when you're communicating with the people who are having challenges which are related to mental health, you better choose to remain silent. Use of silence. Remember, communication is in two categories, verbal or non-verbal. You can be communicating with somebody those people who are having mental issues through non-verbal means or verbal means. I hope you're getting me well. Communication is in two ways, verbal or non-verbal. On non-verbal again, it has examples of non-verbal communication. Look what here. Use of silence. Use of silence. It's just the same as saying to remain quiet. To remain quiet. Remain quiet when you are communicating with a person who has mental health challenges or issues or problems. You remain quiet. You can be communicating whilst you are quiet with someone who has what? Why do you think that is important? So during this particular time, if you are using silence when you are communicating with people with mental health issues, see here they are trying to say you are allowing processing time. You are giving yourself processing time. You want to process things. By processing time, it means you are giving yourself space to gather thoughts and emotions. You are trying to gather thoughts or emotions. How should I go about this particular problem? You are speaking to yourself. Mwina misala uja, kapena mwina all my issues, my problems. Akuvuta kwa mbili. But you are just quiet. You remain quiet just like that. So you're processing. This is a processing time. You are gathering thoughts. How can I go about this particular problem? How can I handle this particular person? One. That's one myth. I mean, one meaning. Because it's a powerful tool sometimes to remain quiet. By doing that, it means you are allowing processing time. You are giving yourself space to gather thoughts and emotions. Number two, if you remain silent whilst you're communicating with those people, it means this thing is trying to encourage reflection. You're encouraging reflection. That is to say, by doing that, it will help you as an individual to connect with your inner experience. It helps you as an individual connect with your inner experiences. You have experiences which you acquired probably whilst you were in a class, or you were in a seminar, you were in a meeting, you talked some issues about on how you can deal with such kind of people when they are causing problems, when they have come to you to seek for intervention. So by remaining quiet, it encourages reflection. You want to reflect. You want to reflect. And this one helps individuals connect with their inner experiences. The things which you had gone through some time back. Apart from that one, use of silence when communicating with the people with mental health problems as a powerful tool, it does what? It shows empathy. It shows empathy. When you are remaining quiet, it shows empathy. Wakuzidwa. Wakuzidwa nae mtu uja. That's why you have chosen to remain quiet. I mean quiet or silent. It shows empathy. Use of silence shows empathy. That is to say, communicates understanding and validity. It shows empathy. Thus, it helps to communicate and understand the situation or the validity. Use of silence again reduces anxiety. Use of silence reduces anxiety. That is to say, It helps to calm the individual and reduce feelings of overwhelm. If you remain quiet, there are some situations which probably you could overreact. You could overdo it. But if you remain quiet, it means this one is very important because it can calm the individual and reduce feelings of overwhelm. You reduce the feelings of overwhelm. You cannot overreact. You took time to think about it, to think about the solution which is supposed to be given to a problem you are encountering. Again, use of silence promotes, it promotes trust. It promotes trust. It promotes trust by creating a safe space for open communication. It creates trust, or it promotes trust by creating a safe space for open communication. Again, use of silence helps to avoid assumptions. Use of silence. If you have decided to remain quiet, it means you are avoiding assumptions.
So to avoid that,
it helps to avoid assumptions.
Both parties must understand this document.
By avoiding assumptions, that is to say, you are preventing making assumptions or jumping to conclusions. You don't want to jump into conclusions. No wonder you've just decided to remain silent.
Information.
Or Z.
Evaluate the pricing.
So you don't think.
And delivery.
You're thinking.
Schedules.
You're contemplating.
If the statement of work does not contain enough details about what services or materials.
To use silence. When you're communicating with the people who are having mental issues or mental problems. So by doing that, it means you don't want to jump into conclusions.
This thing has to be.
You don't want to go into an assumption. No.
Possible.
You are looking for facts. You are looking for best solutions. Again, use of silence supports emotional regulation.
How many
you can control emotions
have to be taken by the client?
Supports emotional regulations. That it helps individuals manage emotions and they respond thoughtfully.
That can also be a mistake, and that mistake can lead into
use of silence.
And,
furthermore, creates a sense of control.
Another
it promotes happens, or it creates a sense of control. That is to say, it empowers individuals to share information when ready.
The contract. So it is that at least this document has to be adopted or has to be issued before a contract.
Remember,
so that when the contractor is silent,
silence does not mean a lack of engagement.
Expected of him.
You are engaged. When you are communicating with someone who has a problem,
there is also
if
a
you are quiet,
of assigning
it means you are disengaging yourself. No.
Inappropriately.
We are communicating. I'm communicating with my friend
the
risk here.
Of assigning responsibility.
Just in a moment, I decide to use silence. I will remain like
so. So, all involved parties.
It doesn't necessarily mean I'm disengaging myself. I'm pulling out from this conversation. No.
To the project.
But probably I'm contemplating about the issues which are pertaining to or which are this, I mean, in connection with what we are discussing.
In that area. In such
maybe I'm looking for a solution to what he has just given. I mean, he has said to me. So it doesn't necessarily mean if I'm quiet during that particular moment in time, I'm lacking engagement. No, that's not the meaning. doesn't necessarily mean a lack of engagement, or it doesn't necessarily mean disinterest. I'm not interested in what he's saying
unnecessarily
or in our conversation. No, that's not an issue. Or it doesn't necessarily mean I'm avoiding him. No,
drafting, this is so.
That's not an issue.
Must also clearly understand who's responsible.
Probably, I want to understand the situation.
Is this going to fail? Who's going to be held responsible here, and who's going to be held responsible there? At least both should be here, so that.
I don't know if you have something to ask me. You can ask if you don't have. Sorry. Allow me to continue. So I'm saying silence can be a powerful tool in communication
appropriately,
because it is allowing individuals to feel heard.
That will delay
at the same time
the implementation of the
or
project
supported.
Let's stop here.
No wonder silence is very, very essential in communication. In the Bible itself, it's talking about listen more, talk less. So you can listen more whilst you are silent. That's when you listen more. And when you decide to speak, speak less, don't speak more. We are going to the third point, respect and dignity of service user when communicating. So that is to say, when you are communicating, you are a social worker, you want to communicate with people who are having mental health challenges, what are you supposed to do? You are supposed to respect the dignity and independence of individuals, those individuals you are communicating with. Is that clear? Respect. Why do you think respect and dignity is very important when you are communicating to people? Respecting people, not only those people who are having mental issues or problems, but I'm asking in general, why do you think respect and dignity is important? I'm hiding these from of service user, but I'm talking about respect and dignity. In communication, why do you think it's important?
Respect and dignity is important when communicating.
I want your class to listen to what she's saying. So you should agree with her or disagree with her as well.
So when communicating with someone, there's need for respect for the person to understand whatever you're going to say, or then dignity, it should be there too. Are you agreeing with me, class? What are you saying?
Why is it important respecting and dignifying people when you are communicating?
I think if you are able to participate. When you are trying to communicate something, you're also able to give you a service for the team. And then the dignity, since you give your body of a social worker, I mean, then those people also give you the awareness of them being able to help you in your required information that you want.
Do you agree or disagree?
Yes.
What if you agree, why were you failing to say what he has said?
What he said is I want to say
that
people want to say it.
Now, that's in general. What about respect and dignity, or respecting or dignifying service users? Why do you think it's important? Or why should you respect or dignify a person who is mentally retarded, a person who has mental problem or challenges when you are communicating with him? Is it necessary? Why do you think so?
Also, it helps them to open up.
To open up what?
Open up with the social media.
Take, for instance, somebody who is in, I mean, whose civility or magnitude of madness has gone to the extreme. He or she doesn't know what you're talking about. She doesn't even understand you. Why do you think such kind of a person should be respected or dignified? Why do you think so? Huh?
I think you're able to get on the same page, because they will get a sense of whereby you're not reacting or you're not overreacting of what they're doing. So in a sense of humor, they would have to, I mean, of course they don't have that mind of them knowing what they're doing, but then in the reduction of them doing the action will be in a minimized manner. I think that's what I'm saying.
Okay. From today onwards they should know this. You'll be encountering different people in your work. Poor, rich, but they have problems. Educated, not educated, but they have problems. Now, whenever they come to you, they are looking for solutions to their problems. Whether that particular patient has been brought by somebody, or a family member, a friend, whosoever is going to brought that particular person, what you should remember, your work requires, it needs you or it demands you to offer this or these two things. Respect or dignity, because they are human beings. Each and every human being, despite the fact is rich or poor, or irrespective of their status, they are equal in the eyes of who? God. They are the same as you are. Despite the fact that during that particular time, you are different. But in the eyes of God, you are the same. So, you need to respect them. You're also supposed to dignify them. Right? Okay. Now, I want you with me to talk something on that one. Okay. When communicating, or when you're communicating with people with mental health issues, it is essential or important to prioritize their respect and dignity. You need to do what? To prioritize. What does that mean? There's a hint there. You need to prioritize their respect and dignity. These things should come first. When communicating with people with mental health issues, it's important or essential to prioritize their respect and what? Dignity. These two are very, very important. And how are you going to do these two things? How are you going to prioritize these two things? Dignity and what? And respect. Wabwela mzimai abo, iwe ndo wa mamuna, social worker, wabwela atavula. So, ababa tukuzi, you need to respect and do what? Dignify. Kabina kwabwela kwa yunatsigana, kwabwela so, inuni na social worker, kwabwela mzibambo, kabina nyamata, ovula di research. When you're looking at this respect and dignity, what does this mean?
Yes, that is it. How they are and whatever the problem that they have, without judging them.
Fine, thank you very much. There are a lot of approaches which you're supposed to use, which are connected to respect and what? Dignity. Approaches which are supposed to be used in connection to what? Respect and what? Dignity. First of all, use personal-centered language. Use personal-centered language. What does this mean? It means you're supposed to address individuals by their preferred name and avoid labels or stereotype. Don't label them. Don't call them. Give them so many names. Person-centered language. Wami sala iwe? One network yoduka iwe? No. So address individuals by their names. Preferred names. If it's James, James. If it's Rhoda, Rhoda. Not wami sala iwe? No. You're not respecting them. You're not dignifying them. Again, maintain confidentiality. Maintain confidentiality. That is to say, respect privacy and confidentiality. Sharing information only with consent. Maybe in the course of trying to treat that particular person or service user, you've identified or you've come across some issues which need privacy. Talk to the guardians. Or there's a certain sensitive information you want to share. Seek consent. Ya mwini wake patient. Can I share this information with your guardian? Yes or no? You're not supposed to share. If that patient says no, it should remain no. Yes, you can go ahead. Are we together? These are the skills, the tips I'm giving you, which you're supposed to use outside there when you're dealing with the problems. When you're communicating with people who are having mental issues, health issues, when you'd like to respect them or to dignify them, maintain privacy. Maintain privacy. Empathize and validate. These two are also in line with the respect and the dignity of, you are trying to respect or dignify service user when you're communicating with them. You need to empathize and also validate. That is to say, you need to acknowledge emotions and experiences. By doing that, it means you are showing and also you are understanding at the same time. You are in line with those two words, respect and dignity. Again, in line with respect and dignity, avoid judgment. As our dear friend there once said, refrain from making assumptions or judgments. What you're supposed to do, just focus on the individual's strengths. Don't look at his or her weaknesses. Focus on individual's strengths. Again, in line with respect and dignity of service user, what are you supposed to do? Foster independence, promote independence. That is to say, you need to support decision making and self-advocacy by promoting independence. You need to promote independence, the independence or autonomy of that particular patient or client. Between you two people, a service user and a service provider, the one who seems to look like is more powerful than the other is you, a service provider. Now, in this case, if when you want to respect and dignify a service user, be aware of power dynamics. Is that a hand?
So, on the power dynamic, promoting independence. Let's say promoting
independence. Is it not the same as allowing the user to make some decisions on their own? Yeah. Give chance to this one. Were you in our class, this class, when we were talking about the person-centered approach? Were you there? Ah, no, I'm asking him.
No.
Oh, that's why. Sometimes there are situations where by you are supposed to. Can you explain to him?
Yes. Oh, yes. I was trying to connect with what you were saying with power quite the nice. Since you're saying allowing the user to make some decisions, then you're coming on the power dynamics of saying you should know.
Power dynamics, that is to say, I was giving an example of saying there are two ends here. You are a service provider. Here is a service user. What most people may think is that the one who is in control is the service user, which is not the case. Sometimes, yes, but in other scenarios, it's not the service user who is in control. That's why I've said you should be aware of power dynamics. That is to say, sometimes if we go to person-centered approach or person-centered care or therapy, a patient is given also a very big chunk when it comes to decision making. You are just there to support. But the decision is supposed to be made by who? It's supposed to be made by who? The service user. You are there to support, just to assist. I may give you a very good example of someone who is a drunkard. A drunkard has reached the extent whereby he's failing to control himself because he's always drunkard. Every day from morning up to afternoon, flat down because of alcohol. Who can control him? Between you and himself. Himself is supposed to control himself. You can come to him to ask him to stop drinking. If he doesn't feel like stopping, can you control him? You can't. The decision lies in himself. I should stop. I'm drinking excessively. I'm over drinking. He should come to his senses to realize that he is over drinking. So sometimes you should be aware, you as service users, I mean providers, you should be aware of these power dynamics. You need to recognize the impact of your position and privilege and sometimes ensuring equal communication. You need to be at par when you are communicating, not just imposing things on him, decisions on him. No, you should also have a say on his situation. Because by doing that, it means you are respecting him, you are dignifying him. You are not controlling him. I hope you have understood me there. What about showing respect for boundaries? Showing respect for boundaries. If you are respecting somebody, if you are dignifying somebody, definitely you give him or her space. You know where to do what and when to do what. When to say what. Because here we are talking about communication. Communicating with such kind of people. You know when to speak what or to say what. By doing that, it means you are showing respect in as far as boundaries are concerned. So you are physically honoring that particular patient. At the same time, you are also recognizing emotional limits. Furthermore, you are avoiding push behavior. If you are respecting service user or you are dignifying a service user, which means you are supposed to use clear and simple language. Use of clear and simple language. That is to say, you'll be avoiding jargons. That's technical jargons or complex terms that will ensure you, that make you understanding him better. Use of clear and simple language. It means you are respecting that particular patient. If you are respecting that particular patient, you should be mindful of nonverbal means or cues. That is to say, you are ensuring body language and tone that is to say, is a sign of conveying respect and empathy. The way how you speak to him will explain a patient to be in a position to say, I think he's respecting me. Do you know this? The way how your tone is, the way how you speak to him or to her, will give him a clear indication to see to it that indeed, I'm being respected, I'm being dignified or not. Again, to show that you are respecting a person or you are dignifying a person, it will be known through the focus on strength. You only be focusing on his or her strength. Don't be a fault finder. Don't be a fault finder. Pamelo kama kala iwe kungo lakala kuzingu na zola kwa kazo kazo kaza mundu. Focus on strength. That is to say, you need to emphasize abilities and resilience rather than deficits or limitations, weaknesses. No. Don't focus on those things. Look at the abilities. Look at the resilience. You need to emphasize those. So I said, when you're communicating with people with mental challenges or issues, health issues, you need to prioritize respect and what? Dignity. So by prioritizing and respect and the dignity, it means you are creating a safe, supportive environment, and also you are promoting trust and effective communication. Let us look at we want to work communication context when you are working with vulnerable old people. Communication context when we are working with vulnerable older people, or verbal and nonverbal communications when we are working with vulnerable older people. Any film ni vulnerable older people. What can you give me examples of vulnerable older people? Magogo. Magogos. Mm-hmm. They are lacking any kind of support. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Magogo. Ma widowers. Ma widows. It. That is in a bus. This they can be termed in the feet. It. Nkalamba. And Okalamba, Jagodika, those are vulnerable old people. Now, they are saying communication context. When you're communicating, they are not going to be verbal and non-verbal communication. They are not going to be communicating challenges when you want to communicate with those vulnerable old people. So, working with vulnerable older people, consider the following or many communication context factors. There are some factors in the course of communication you're supposed to look into. I don't know if you are getting me well. You are interested to communicate or to work with vulnerable older people. There are so many factors that you are supposed to look into. So many factors which you are supposed to look into when you want to communicate or to work with these people. One, sensory impairment. Are you aware kutikawiri kawiri andrawawa okalambawa? My senses are amakala kuti they are dwindling. Akupita kumadzulo. Some of the sensory nerves, they are stopping working. They stop working. So, factor number one, we can call it sensory impairments. Sensory impairments or disabilities. Non-functioning. Sensory impairment. That is to say, be aware, you should be aware of hearing, be aware of hearing, vision, or speech difficulties. And adapt communicating accordingly. You need to be aware of those things. When you are communicating with them, or when you are working with them, bear in mind that there are some problems which they are having, more especially when it comes to communication context. Number two could be cognitive changes. Cognitive changes. They are thinking. Their thinking capabilities lowers as well. Eh? So be patient sometimes when you're communicating or you are working with them. Be patient and clear with them. Considering, whilst you're considering potential memory loss. See? And I mean, well, when it comes to memory, they are losing memory. So be patient with them, be clear with them, considering potential memory loss and confusion. Again, look at the physical limitations. Physical limitations. Sometimes when it comes to mobility, kutia and the movement is difficult to them. Huh? So consider mobility, pain, or fatigue when you want to work with them. Think along those lines. These people, they have fatigue. These people They cannot go far when it comes to mobility. They have some pains. And so on and so forth. Think along those lines of physical limitation. They have physical limitations. Again, when you want to work with them, think about their emotional vulnerabilities. Emotional vulnerabilities. Inu magogo tu sakuna mize ni sama chilo kukwia. My emotions ama kanoba fubiko basi. Be emphatic, and also you need to understand and acknowledge potential anxiety and depression or grief with their in. You two people, leave your phones by table. You leave your phone by table. The addiction, eh? You're addicted to phones, eh? Ah, no, that's not true. No. Again, you need to consider social isolation. Think along those lines. Think about social isolation. Socially, these vulnerable older people are being isolated. Be aware of potential loneliness and disconnectedness or disconnection. They are being disconnected. At the same time, they are also lonely most of the times. Loneliness ima kwabula kwambira ndamene. Kumaso disconnection. They are being disconnected. They are being left out in most of the cases. I mean most of the times. I think today we should stop here on this point. Chimakajilian. Today is 14th, 15th. 15th. Hey.